Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United proudly presents the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. It's every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx, New York, and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or handout from Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio programs will be recorded and archived on YouTube's GAHFU channel for on-demand listening. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund and the William and Flora Hewitt and the James Irvine Foundation.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome tonight. We want to welcome each and every one of you tonight to our session one, lecture number three, with Dr. Theodore Aranda, all the way from Dangriga, Belize. Surusia, buti gunyo, ida binya gunyo to.
Biti, maiba digit yage ba, omi magadi ugat yage. Nagade hagil ba yanule.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you so much, doctor. The microphone is yours. So let's get started with lecture number three.
Yes. Biti rambabe hon sumutu, good evening to everybody. Every listener around the world and around the Americas. Let us first begin with some of the things that we talked about last week. And that one of them was that Christopher Columbus never said that he landed in the Americas. He did not. As a matter of fact, when he landed in the Americas, he ran into natives who had some gold, and that gold was one that came from Guinea, and they told him over and over and over again that black men had been coming from Africa and trading with them in gold and other things. Salt is another one. Almeza is another one. Almeza is a cloth that was fabricated and manufactured in Guinea. And those people traveled in boats. They called them Almeria. And the gold that they were making and that they made in Guinea. And I wanted to remember this. That gold was made in Guinea. And it was 18% gold. I mean, it was 32 points total. 18 points was gold. 6 points was silver. And 8 points was copper. So when Columbus saw that with the natives there, he was flabbergasted because he did not anticipate to run into such treasures in the Americas. So he took the gold and sent it back to Spain to be acid. Acid means they break it down to bits and pieces. And it was proven by Spain also that that gold was the same gold that was manufactured in Guinea. Guinea is a part of Africa and it's the west side of Africa. So there is no question about the fact, and he did not deny it either, that he was not the very first to arrive in those areas. Other people who saw these black people from Africa traveling into the Americas were, one, the King Don Juan of Portugal. He said that over and over again, that he saw people from Africa traveling into America with merchandise and trading with the people. Then there were others, and I'm just reviewing now, I'm just pointing out some of the people that we spoke about last week. Ferdinand Columbus, the son of Columbus, who traveled with his father on some of those trips, landed in Panama, I mean, went to Honduras, and I want Hondurans to be proud of this. in Honduras, the son of Christopher Columbus said over and over again that the people he saw there in the northeast of Honduras were people who resembled and looked like the people from Guinea. The son of Christopher Columbus said that. And the other point is that we are reviewing, remember that, that there were places in what today is Panama. The Panama used to be called Darien, D-A-R-I-E-N. And those places were there, the names of those places was there up to the time that the Panama Canal was excavated. And there are four names I'm going to give you. Mandinga Bay is one. And the people who arrived in Panama, those people who traveled in gold, were a Mandinga people, because we are the descendants of a Mandinga people. We are offshoots of Mandinga. Then there was Caracol Point. Caracol Point is a point in what used to be Panama, but now is, I mean, what used to be Darien, sorry, but now is Panama. There is also Mandingo, there is a Mandinga settlement. That too was a settlement in Panama, and there was the Sierra de Mali. Sierra de Mali would be the mountains of Mali. They were there. And Christopher Columbus said the first Christian mass in the Americas after a wreckage, after he ran into a hurricane there, and some of our people in Honduras remember the ancestors telling them that they were, that Columbus indeed had the, I mean, had that, I mean, difficulty with the hurricane, number one. And it was around Puerto Castilla, around Trujillo today. And among the people that I met in Honduras, who I visited and spoke to, and they told me that their ancestors told them that they saw Columbus when he arrived in the Americas. One of them is Filomena Barona de Bonilla. The other one was a Miranda family. And the other one was a Marin family. So that there is no question about it. And I'm going to shift a little from here so that at least I can make this point clear. All of all of the Caribbean, the gold that Columbus met was in Haiti. The people that were saw, I mean, that were found by other explorers were in Panama or Darien at that time. Some of them were in Honduras long before Columbus. But the thing to remember here is this. They are, the Hondurans are still at the same place where they were when Christopher Columbus landed in Honduras. They were in the northeast section of Honduras, and this, the Garifunas are still there today. As a matter of fact, the Hondurans are the only Garifuna people that never moved away from where they were when they landed and when they did the trading and everything else. Hondurans are still there, where, and Christopher Columbus met them there. So, indeed, and in fact, Honduras is very significant in the history of the Garifuna people. It is the only one place that did not, where the people were not moved, because those in Darien, they lost their language. In Panama, that is, all right? Darien, Panama, one and the same. They lost the language. Those in Urumqi lost the language, and those that were defeated in the war were expelled from Urumqi. The only place that has not moved and did not move, and they were never pushed anywhere else, and they stayed where they had been, where they used to do the trade, is Honduras. Here in Belize, quite a few times, especially when I was a little boy, we used to believe that Belizeans were the, quote, number one guerrilla. We need to discuss that at length, because Honduras has quite a lot of characteristics and things, like they speak the language better than us here in Belize. When it comes to the culture, they have maintained it. The tradition, they have maintained it. So we have to respect Honduras as one of the first places that the Garifuna people would stay in, and up to today are there. Now, the second thing I have to do right now before I continue is, I was given two questions. One question was, can you explain why Garifuna language has documented closer words with Carib and words with Mandinga? That was the question. Let me repeat. Can you explain why the Garifuna language has documented closer words with Carib than with words of the Mandinga? My answer to that question is, I cannot answer you because I don't speak Carib. I speak Garifuna. Mamao Carib, Garifunao. And in Menega didn't Garifuna. I mean, Menega didn't Carib. We said it last week. I don't remember seeing a Carib ever at all. When I was a little kid, I used to think that Caribs were black people like me, because they were calling us Caribs all over the place. And the only people I saw that were called Caribs are those in Hopkins, in Belize, Honduras, and them. We have never called ourselves Caribs. So I don't know how to answer that question, because I don't know Caribs. Neither do I speak Carib. The same goes for Arawak. I met two Arawak some time ago, but they were indigenous people. And from what I was told by some people from the Orinoco area, from people like Venezuela, is that the Caribs who are there are Amerindian people. So I can't say to you that, neither do I accept the fact that the words were Carib words, because I don't speak Carib, and I don't think any of us speak Carib. As to Mandinga, I don't know Mandinga either. I don't speak the language. It's the origin of the Garifuna language, all right, but I don't speak Mandinga. So I cannot answer that question, and the person who speaks, or who says, or who is asking the question about Garifuna language being documented closer to Carib, that person needs to answer the question for himself. Does that person speak Carib, so that he can say Carib and the Garifuna, one comes from the other? Does he speak Carib? The second part of it is, if you tell me that the words are closer to Mandinga, then you are telling me in a way that you speak Mandinga. That, and it's not Mandinga either, it's Mande. Mande is the language. Mandinga are the people and the land. It's just like in Garifuna. The word Garifuna is the language, the culture, Garifuna. But the people, Wagia Garinagu, Garinagu, Wagia. So that question I can't answer. And I would very much like to invite the person who asked the question to tell us as to whether or not he speaks Carib, and that he speaks Mande or Mandinga language. The second question that I was asked was, where do we get our Spanish names from? Throughout our schooling, we had been told that were last names, like for instance Miranda, Castillo, etc., were Spanish words. Again, I'm going to answer you in the fashion that I know. Don't forget ever that Africans colonized Spain, and they were the ones who civilized Spain. I'll say that a little later on again. It was Africans who civilized Spain, and they controlled Spain for 800 years. For 800 years, from 700 BC AD to 1500 AD, they were in control of Spain. They civilized Spain. So it's very possible that the Spaniards adapted African names, sometimes changed them, sometimes contracted them. In other words, they shortened the word or they add something else to it. So you can't tell me that our names, Castillo, the this and the that, are Spanish names. What I can tell you is about Aranda. Aranda. The word Aranda is a Nigerian word, and it means worker. So Aranda is not a Spanish name. It's an African name. And I would like each and every one of you to spare me, to sort of go back in your history if you can, to see where your last name originated from. It's not Spanish. But because it was the Spaniards who came to the Latin Americas and gave the Latin Americans those names, they believed that those were those are Spanish names. No, they're not. Not necessarily so. They could have been, and many of them are African names which the Spaniards adapted when they were a colony to the Africans. Moors are the people, for about 800 years. It's just like here in Belize, for instance, you'll find quite a few people with, quote, English names. And they may want to tell you that they're English. That's up to them to say so. But that's not an issue at this moment. The point is, you cannot tell me that our last names are Spanish names. Mine is not. Mine is an African word from Nigeria. I ran into big people there with that name. As a matter of fact, quite a lot of them. Some of them are Randas, some of them are Vandas, some of them are Sandas, some of them are Tandas in Nigeria. And in Zimbabwe, I ran into quite a few people with the last name. So my name, that's one name I can tell you, is not a Spanish name, even though I've heard a lot of people say that it's a Spanish name. It is not a Spanish name. Okay? And there was another question also, and it was a sort of a suggestion, which I kind of welcome in a way, that we should continue these lectures for more time so that at least we can understand our history better. And that we could indeed make sure that our children learn their history. I cannot answer that with a yes or no, because I'm working along with GAHFU, and I'm developing a park also, Africa to America Park, and I'm going to work, and I have been working, and I will continue working with the Garifuna Nation from U.S. So we may need to continue those conversations, all right, but it would not depend upon me per se. It's myself and the rest of my colleagues. This series of lecture is sponsored by GAHFU. Now, let's go on to something. Now, this is our lecture for today. I'm going to go into the contributions of Africa to the civilization of the world. Let me repeat that. Contribution of Africa to the civilization of the world. The first thing that we need to understand is that the first civilization ever, first advanced civilization, was African. It started in Ethiopia, and it culminated to the highest in Egypt. And from there it spread throughout the rest of the world, so that every civilization on earth, every civilization on earth sprang from or directly is influenced by Egypt and by Africa. That's one thing we must always be proud of. Our African ancestry gave birth to civilization in the world and civilized the whole world. Africa was the first nation, well, not nation, sorry about that, because Africa is not a nation, Africa is a continent, okay? The Africans were the first from, as I said to you, from Ethiopia into Egypt, into Mali, Sangai, Ghana, etc. Those were the people who joined the sciences and the technologies to the teachings, that is philosophy, for instance, the humanities, that is what you want to be, this or the other. They joined, or they used the sciences to build the structures that spread the belief. Let's deal with two for a while. Number one, the Africans built the biggest and the tallest pyramid in the world. Giza is the most famous of them. Giza was built because the Africans had the technology, they had the science to be able to build the pyramids of Egypt. Pyramids of Egypt. They were very good at physics. They started the sciences of physics, mathematics, astronomy, geometry, and engineering. And they built that monument because the interest was to find out what's up there in space. That's how and that's why began the study of astronomy. The astronomy that we have in our booklet, I built it in the planetarium that I have in the booklet. I built it into a pyramid because the pyramid of that time, the pyramid of that time was the only means of studying space. They studied the stars. They studied the planets. And they were able to spread that information even into the Americas here today. That's one. They built the Sphinx. Sphinx is one of the most fascinating structures of the earth. And what they did was, the universities, because they were the ones who started out the universities, they used the universities, their humanities, belief in crime, in God, all those abstract sciences, even medicine, they started all of those at the university level. But they did not keep those informations to themselves in the universities, but rather they used the knowledge that they had from the universities. They used the knowledge that they had from their own experiences to dam their waters, engineering, irrigation, to build the pyramids. And the pyramid, as I said to you, was the tallest structure up to very, very few years ago. And it was for 3,800 years, the tallest structure in the world. That was Giza Pyramid. Then the universities, the first to exist and the first to be built, were built by the Africans, partly in Egypt, and partly in the west coast of Africa. So we have to be able to know and understand that our people have made tremendous contributions to the development of the world. Now let's go to this other one. And you, Garifuna, hold on to your seat, because I'm coming at you with something that you never ever thought of. Number one, Africa is where religion and morality is or are rooted. Africa is where religion began. Africa is where morality began. And all our legacies, moral legacies, and all our revealed religions, whether you are talking about Christianity, you are talking about Judaism, or you are talking about any other religion, Islam, for example, all of those sprang from Egypt. Now, all religions are embodied, well, I have to break that piece down because I don't want to use the large word. All religions are contained in the doctrine of monotheism. Monotheism is the doctrine that one God is the one who is all-knowing, almighty. He is present everywhere. He is eternal, immortal, perfect, creator of the universe, I mean, source of all good and infinite. Okay, the only thing here is this. The Africans did not call those powers, those forces, those energies God. They did not. What they hold on to, and it is something that we still have today, what they say or what they hold on to is the energy behind all of those is the, they call him Amen. Remember when you pray, when we all pray at the end of the prayer, like BSB, etc., Iterella or Amen? Amen does not mean the Iterella. Amen is the force, the energy behind everything, the energy that creates the universe, that is all, everything springs from that energy. It's all over. It is eternal, immortal. Now, what the Christians and the others have done is personalize those energies so that they tell you God created the earth. Amen Ra means, Amen Ra is the name that we are talking about here. As a matter of fact, the name would be no name. That's a proper translation for it. Amen Ra is the unknowable. So that when you read in the Bibles of today that God is unknowable, it is strictly an African idea. Not only is Amen Ra unknowable, it is also present everywhere, knows everything, almighty, immortal, perfect, creator of the universe, the source of all good, and infinite. That's a teaching by our ancestors, the Africans. And up to today, let me challenge anyone, up to today, let me get anybody who can give me the definition of what we call God, and it's not that. Because that is the definition of Amen Ra. The only thing about it is we don't call it Amen Ra ends in, with a specific name like God. No, we don't. It's evolution that got that to us today. So religion and the morality is the, one of the greatest gifts of Africa, Egypt, the universities of Mali, the universities of Shanghai, and the, throughout the entire African world. That was their contribution to the rest of us. Now, I'm going to take you one more step further. If you want to understand what a Christian church is, the most and the best place to understand it is the Dabuyaba. Let me repeat that. One needs only to understand the Dabuyaba to understand or to see where present-day churches and the temples are rooted. I have been to the Basilica of Rome, not once, not twice. The biggest pictures, the statues, the things that are there. If you understand the G, if you understand Dabuyaba, and if you understand those churches, you will see that they all sprang from Dabuyaba. Okay? Now, there are so many of us today who want to speak about Dugu like the work of the devil. All right. I'm not going to argue with you about that. The only point I'm going to make to you is this. The Dugu is the ceremony, it is the biggest ceremony and the clearest and the most and the oldest evidence of petition. That's the good. The good is a petition. Mali is a petition. It is healing. It's a healing process. You go there to be healed. It's an atonement. Atonement means to make up for the wrongs that you have done. You praise the Lord God and the ancestors. And it's a thanksgiving to the one and almighty God. That's what Mali is and that's what Dugu is. If only you understood it, you are the beginner of the religions and the morality of the world. Morality is living, and it's the Africans who taught us that also, to living the precepts of forgiveness, atonement, and the rest. And up to today, we still look to the teachings of the churches and teachings of the Africans. That means, look at the Ten Commandments. You may not have heard, you may not be hearing much about Ten Commandments today. But the Ten Commandments are extracted, in other words, they were drawn from the 42 negative confessions. A 42 negative confessions in Africa. When somebody dies, which means we are trying to pray for him to the Almighty and Eternal Amen Ra to show him the way so that he can soul save his soul. And it goes on and on. We make offerings along the way because when Osiris, the first god named by the Egyptians, when Osiris died, that was, he goes, I mean, the people, his followers, his, I mean, friends, family, etc., pray for him. Pray for the atonement of his soul so that he can move on into the world of, we call it Seiri in Garifuna, or heaven in their languages. That's our contribution. And we cannot and should not forget that at all, ever. So, what was the pyramid there for? What was the Ten Commandments? What were the Duguand? And what is religion today? That's exactly what it is. And if anyone wants to argue with that, they can do so. But if we know our Africanness, and we know our religions, and we know morality, you can argue with it if you want to. And up to today too, the moralities that are practiced, they are all extracted from the 42 negative confessions, or from the Ten Commandments, if you want to put it that way. The Ten Commandments were extracted from the negative confessions, and the negative confessions were the teachings of the Africans. There are other things that come out of that. One, Africans teach, and will not tolerate anything less, respect for the elders and the ancestors. That's up to today. That comes out of the Ten Commandments, out of the negative confessions, out of the morality of this of the Africans. Respect for the elders and the ancestors. All right, these were some of the things that I can point out to you as contribution of Africa to each, I mean, to the world. Now, the second part to it is this. Europe was civilized by Egypt. Europe was civilized by Egypt. And the first Europeans to be civilized by the Africans were the Egyptians. The Egyptians, the Egyptians civilized Europe. They first started in Egypt. Then they also civilized Spain. Then they also civilized France and England. The first European nation, now let me repeat that because I think I made a mistake there. The first European nation to be civilized by the Egyptians was Greece. Greece. I made a mistake with that, because there's a little misprint here. But Egypt was the first to civilize Greece. And the Greeks taught that civilization to the Romans. Those were in Rome, in Europe. But the Romans lost it. And when the Romans lost it, they were under uncivilization for quite some years, until the Moors, another set of Africans, came back and then civilized the Spaniards. I have told you that they colonized the Spanish for 800 years, I think it is, colonizing. And while Spain was the power in Spain at that time, or in Europe at that time, the English, the French, and the Germans went there to absorb the knowledge from the Africans. These ideals, these things that I'm pointing out to you, the fact that Africans made an enormous contribution to the development of the world, those are teachings that are contained and are in Garifunaness. And I repeat that. These ideas are contained in Garifunaness. So, and they are going to be in the Africa to America Park. We are going to teach that. And I'm a member of the Garifuna Nation. That too is something that we are going to go into. Now, let's take a walk from the Olduvai Gorge. I think I've told you before that Olduvai Gorge is where humankind began. And the first people on earth were Africans. But because this was never taught to us in school, we didn't know it at all. However, let's take a good look at this. If you have the map there that could show the Africa, the GarifunaJourney, and you look to the right of it, to the extreme right, the east of it, you can see Olduvai Gorge there. Humankind started migrating, that is, moving away from the area where they were indeed born or where they evolved, etc. But as they evolve, that is, as they move from Olduvai Gorge, they started moving in all sorts of directions. Some of the directions they went to was northeast, which would be Asia today. Straight north would be what Europe is today. And the rest of Africa is what would be southwest and northeast. When we moved from there, it took us thousands and thousands of years. But as we moved, we went through and developed a journey of thousands of years and evolved and adapted to new environments. As a matter of fact, when you move from place to place, you have to adapt to the conditions of the place that you are in. And we call that you adapt and you evolve to a new environment. If you don't adapt to the environment in which you are, you will perish. You won't survive. So our Garifuna ancestors, now this is the thing, we were still Africans, strictly Africans. We moved from there and spread throughout the rest of the world. There was no humans on earth other than us. Some went north to Europe, some went east to Asia, some went west to the rest of Africa. And they had to survive within those environments, so they had to adapt to what that is. But as those Africans went, there was one set of Africans that moved west. And if you watch the, there is a red streak that I have there from Olduvai Gorge moving west to what is Guinea today. All right. As our Garifuna ancestors moved from the Olduvai Gorge across Africa, they had to have adapted to quite a few environments, but in so doing they started forging an identity. In other words, they started being a little separate people. Yes, they were Africans. Yes, they were black. Yes, they were there. They were natives of the area. However, they started developing some identity, some things about them, like for instance the way they eat, the food they eat, how they cover themselves from the elements, etc. All of those things started giving them what we call an identity. In other words, They do this, they do that, they do the other. And they no longer are like the others. Let's say those who move west, south for instance, because they live in different environment, they have to adapt to that environment. Those who move north, they have to adapt to that environment, like for instance the cold of Europe. And that is how the white people are formed. That was how they evolved. Because the people who went to Europe were Africans, were our ancestors. However, because they remained in the cold for such a long time, they lived there for at least 20,000 years, they evolved into something else. So that the lightness of the skin of a white person is not any sign of superiority. It is the environment that makes it so, not because of anything else. All right. As our ancestors moved, therefore, they established a heritage. Heritage simply means that you start doing things in a specific way. Like, for instance, the food that you're going to eat, you cook it in a certain way. The animals that you choose to want to eat, they are special animals to you, and you'll hunt them down to eat. And you teach that to your children, to the younger ones, so that they too can develop or can pursue what you have already started. And in doing that, eating certain foods, whatever food it is, whether it's a root of fruit or bark or whatever it is, you start teaching that to your children because it is the food. The animals that you hunt are the animals that you teach your children to hunt, and you teach them how to hunt them. So in other words, you start developing what I call a heritage. And the third one, the fourth or whatever, is the evolution of a culture. A culture is when you have adapted to your environment, you have forged an identity, you have established a heritage. In other words, you have developed a certain thing that you learned from your parents. Your ancestors teach you that, you see that, the food you eat, how you prepare it, etc. And that's what we call culture. The music you play, the dance you dance, the people that you choose to be your friends, etc. All of that becomes a culture. And after a while, you evolve and you develop into a specific people. You are then known by the environment you live in. You are known because you have forged an identity. You are recognized because the heritage that you have built. You are recognized because of the culture that you have. And that is what makes you a specific person. Now, what we have done, or what I have done, we established a study some time ago. It was 2010. I wanted to know, therefore, what makes Garifuna distinct and distinguished from the others. Let's say, for instance, an Igbo, or Maasai, or Fulani, etc. Those are all African tribes. What is there that makes us, Garinago, different from those people? Not in the sense that we are superior, and so not because we are no longer Africans, because we still are. But the identity of the Griffin people started coming through. And what we did was, we did a study in 2010, and I led some 16 Garifuna people who I know are of Garifuna heritage, Garifuna ancestry. Some of them come from Guatemala, some from Honduras, some from Belize, and I asked them to participate in a genographic study conducted by the National Geographic and IBM. And the reason for that is to be able to show with scientific evidence that Garinagu are the same people that came from those that sprang from Olduvai Gorge, moved about Africa, etc., and ended up by Guinea, and by the Atlantic Ocean. This was very, very important for us, because we needed to be sure that what we are saying is indeed researchable and indeed true. This study did exactly that. It traced our ancestry from the Olduvai Gorge. This is the point I want to make to you. From the Olduvai Gorge, they traveled or migrated across Africa. And from there, they crossed over to the coast of Guinea, of Northwest Africa. But when we got there, we ran into this huge Atlantic Ocean, which we needed to cross if we were going to continue or whatever. I continued that journey to identify whether those people who had been crossing the Atlantic Ocean are the same ancestors that we had. And yes, they were the same people that had started way, way back for more, I don't know how long, for more than 50,000 years maybe. It's a long, long journey. And along the way, and this is the thing that we need to understand, along the way, they adapted to new environment. These people who we now call Garifuna, they adapted to new environment, forged an identity, established a heritage, evolved a culture, developed a specific people, and they spoke a specific language. And today, I'm very, very happy and proud that when I run into a Honduran, we can speak the same language even though we live in different areas. When I go to Labuga, the same. And those that are now in the U.S., we speak the same language. That language, Garifuna, binds us through our history. Binds us because we adapted to the environment. It binds us because we have an identity. It binds us because we have an heritage. It binds us because we evolved the culture. It binds us because we are a specific people. And that language, Garifuna, is ours. That's where and that's how we learned to be what we are. So when we got to the coast of Guinea and there was no more land to cross, our ancestors who were traders, who were sailors, seamen, etc., crossed the Atlantic Ocean and ended up in the Americas trading with the natives of America. And that's where we became Garifuna. Because the word Garifuna means those who traffic in gold. And we did do that. That's what we were. That's what we did. And that's what makes us Garifuna. So let's drop this nonsense of, Arawak or Carib. No. We evolved because we migrated, and we migrated as a people. And we developed as a people. And this is a crucial connection in the history of the Garifuna people and the African progenitors that needs to be understood. If you don't understand that in that fashion, you don't quite understand your history. Okay? But because that was never taught to us in that fashion, and we did not know our own history, the history that was given to us, that we were descendants of African slaves, Arawaks, and Caribs, it offers and it leads us into shallow assumptions and separate us from our African people. Without this connection, that is, without connecting ourselves to our roots, without connecting ourselves to our history and our continuation, we cannot conclude, neither can we actually show that we are one people, the Garifuna people, linguistically, culturally, spiritually, logically, and scientific. And we are the children of those people who crossed the Atlantic Ocean. Ronnie?
Yes, Doctor. Yes, we're listed in attentively. Thank you.
Okay. We are almost, time is over. I think I would prefer to stay here for a while, because if I pick up something else, we will not finish it.
Okay. Great lecture. So, excellent. Very revealing, Doctor. I have a question from Yolanda Savio. She posted the question on the Facebook page for the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy. This is the question. What is the relation between the African traders on Yurumein who were deported to Honduras to the Garinagu that were on the northeast coast thousands of years before Columbus?
They were one and the same people. Our Garifuna people occupy the entire Caribbean, we call it today. It goes from, as I mentioned a little earlier, it goes from Panama. They go to north coast of South America, all the way to Brazil. Those were areas that our people, that our ancestors occupied. They traded and they did traffic there. They did business in that area. And they go all the way, as I said to you, all the way up the Caribbean, all the way to more or less where Florida is, today, all of that area, including Cuba, etc., because that's what Guanahani was. And as I said, some were in Panama, and some of them went to Honduras. And those that are in Honduras are as Garifuna as the others. The only thing is that all the others, because of slavery, the this and the other, they lost their identity, they lost their Garifunaness, while Honduras still speaks the language. Those of us who were in Yurume or in the Caribbean, let's put it that way, we spoke our language, and when we were expelled from home, we never lost our language. That's why we were expelled, because we refused to lose our language. And we are exactly the same as those in Honduras. And those in Honduras, let me go back a bit. We were in Yurume, we were in Panama, we were in South America, but as we migrated and moved, we started being a people, and we were identified as a people. And when the British came and expelled those of us from Yurume, whom they could not dominate, they sent them to Honduras because they knew that we were one and the same people.
Very good. So, thank you.
Mm-hmm. So it's not simply a matter of the British by any chance taking us over. No. It was intended that we could not come back to Yurume. That was the idea behind it.
Beautiful.
The intention was to destroy us as a people. But they could not, because when we got to Honduras, those in Honduras, some of them had migrated to Nicaragua, some of them had migrated to Guatemala, and from there we migrated to Belize. So we are one and the same people.
Thank you,
Doctor. Same language, have the same culture. Oh, we dance the same to the same music, and we believe the same things.
Yes, indeed. Another question, Doctor, from Garifuna Duvalier Pablo Blanco. He is in New York. He says, please, Doctor, explain the Garifuna language. Why do we speak a language that originates in Amazon basin of South America? The emphasis... The emphasis should be placed on the language, because that's what really define us as Garifuna. The culture is practiced on the rails of the language. I see the African angle, but the evidence shows we lean more towards the indigenous Amerindian Caribbean angle.
Okay, is that his question?
Yes, it is. That's it.
Ronnie, all of last week and prior to that, I explained the fact that we are not Amerindians. No, we are Africans. And the thing is that so many of these people continue believing the story of the British, that we are the origin of a shipwreck and married Arawaks and Caribs. We did not. We are Garina. And that's exactly what I wanted to show today. What I want to show today is that we are Africans who evolved in Africa, traveled in Africa, and crossed the Atlantic Ocean into the Caribbean and made home for ourselves here in the Americas. We are not Arawaks. And maybe what I need to say to a person who comes up with an argument like that is, it is nothing else but the belief that when British tell you something that it is true, the British have been lying to you all over, and they even wanted to tell you that they discovered the Americas. So the answer to that question is definitely not. Our language is an African language, originated from Mande, and we spoke it there, and we continue speaking it today. And that is one thing that ties us together. Let me ask that person, does he speak Carib? Ask that person that question, because I think I dealt with that a little earlier. Does he speak Carib? Does he understand Carib? Number one. Number two, does he understand Arawak? Does he?
Yes. Good question. Doctor, the last two questions from Janet Witi Savio, before we let you go. Has there been any DNA studies done on Garinagum to determine our origin? And
that,
two.
That's remember I told you about the study that we did. This was 2010.
Yes.
Where I said that we selected 16 Garifuna people.
Very
and
good.
Those people we know are people from Honduras, from Guatemala, and Belize. And we did a DNA study. We call it genographic. I didn't use the word DNA, I used the word genographic. And it proved that we are the same people that moved from Olduvai Gorge and landed in the Guinea area and crossed the Atlantic, trading with the natives in the Americas.
Excellent.
That we did that. I have done that study already. Yeah. The only thing that we need to do now, and I hope that we can indeed do it, and I believe we will, we will need to go back to Guinea, to Gambia, to Senegal. I have been to those places, all right, but when I went there, I wasn't going there to do this analysis or this study. And those people are exactly like us. Exactly like us. So what we need to do, therefore, is to go back there and study the tradition, the things that they believe, the things that they do. I do know that they hold on to very many of the cultural things that we hold on to. Like, for instance, respect for the ancestors. Respect for, the notion that God is almighty. All of those are there still. But we need to make a specific trip to see some of the other traditions that they have. Let's say, for instance, the first time, to be honest with you, Aran, the first time I saw Mali was in Nigeria. It was after I saw that thing in Nigeria that I saw it in Belize.
Wow. Wow.
So, we have done that.
Excellent.
We have.
And the next question, this is the final question, Dr. Aranda, is what is the reason for the Africanization of the Garinagum?
It's not an Africanization of the Garinagum, because the Garinagum are not Africanized. The Garinagum are Africans. It's just like you're telling me, why is a dog a dog?
Yes.
Are Africans. They are not Africanized. These are the words that the historians, the anthropologists, those who lean to the fact that Garinagum are not Africans and not this, because that is what they were taught. That's what they studied. And they believe it because it's British who said it. I am saying to you, and I have done this study, this took me a long, long time. We are not in any way, shape, or form Africanized. We are Africans.
Wow,
it's just like Italian. Let's say, for instance, if I were to ask you, why is a mango a mango? Mango is a mango because it's a mango.
Yes.
There's another expression. If you talk like if you quack like a duck, walk like a duck, and whatever, you are a duck. So, no, these are basically the people who believed that story, that we were established or we became great when the shipwreck of 1635. But we have said it, and I've said it in these three lectures today, we were here 6,000 years at least before the Europeans. We are no mixture of Arawaks. We are no mixture of these. We were never slaves. By the time the Europeans got here, that is what they found. But they couldn't believe the fact that we were so advanced because of the fact that the idea behind the British, the white individual, the European, is that they are superior to us. Therefore, we couldn't do it. As a matter of fact, today, Rani, today there are very many people who believe that Africans did not build Giza Pyramid, that Africa did not build and Sphinx. It is in Egypt. There were even those who want to say that Egypt is not in Africa.
Wow.
If they don't, they, let them look at the geography for that.
Well, thank you so much, Doctor, for tonight's lecture. Very revealing. Ladies and gentlemen, we encourage you to send your questions via Facebook, via email, by text. You can text me by at the following number, 323-898-6841. One more time. 323 is the area code, 898-6841. You could text me your questions, you could email the questions, and we will post the questions to Dr. Aranda, and next Wednesday, he will get a chance to address each one of the questions from all of our listeners.
Okay, one last comment before we end the meeting.
Yes.
And number one, could you please send the link to the Christian Times of New York, because they want it. They want to have it registered and to be able to get the information that you distribute into the website. Okay? Please,
yes.
Please do that for me. And the second part to it is that those gentlemen who ask those questions, let them not feel bad that the information that they had been given were wrong. That's what all of us were taught. It's only because we found that they were faulty. There is no truth in them. It's wrong. That I did, when I did this study and found this out, I said, I can't leave my country, I can't leave my people believing the rubbish that the British taught us.
Wow.
That's the end of that today. So let him not feel bad about my answer. We are not Africanized. No, sir. We are Garina. We are Africans.
Wow.
Okay, Rani. Good night.
Good night, Sorusia. Thank you so much. And I will be sending you some of the questions that are arriving at this point. We have another question from another listener, which I'm going to make available via email at this point. Thank you so much,
right,
Sorusia Buitiguño, and we'll see you next week.
Web. Ayo.
Yes, ayo, Buitiguño. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we are live and direct. This is your weekly radio show online, and we're talking about the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy, which is brought to you courtesy of the Alliance for California Traditional Arts, ACTA, and of course through your donations as well. We are taking donations on our website, GarifunaHeritageFoundation.org, to help us pay for the airtime, the credits that we have to use to be able to call a long distance to Belize, to Guatemala, to Honduras, as we bring these programs to you. Any donations are welcome. It could be $1, it could be $5. It doesn't matter. Any amount will help. Thank you so much. And we will go to New York in a minute to get an update report on the weekly activities that are going on in the Garifuna community with Budari Palacios from Budari Dance Company. ¿Qué motia?
Hola, mi celuma. Hola, mi celuma. Bayanu hanuma.
On behalf of Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United, we thank you for joining us tonight to the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy online. Don't forget, tune in every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx. and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or the handout from our Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio shows are recorded or archived for your online demand. So you can find it on YouTube, GAHFU channel, anytime, 24/7. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund, the William and Flora Hewitt, and the James Irvine Foundation. Mama,